get started, if you noticed the attendance last week, it was fairly decent considering the situation we're in as churches in our community, and hopefully it'll be better today before the day's service is concluded. This is the 12th Sunday of the wonderful season of Pentecost. It's the 23rd day of this month. We have a few things we'd like to just share with you. The bulletins, of course, we're back to having bulletins for our worship service, and it's very helpful to remind you that people that prepared these bulletins wore masks, they wore gloves, they did this for you, so we appreciate their efforts. And as far as congregational singing, today will be very similar to last Sunday. When it comes to the Gloria Patri and doxology, we will recite this, but maybe in the near future we'll be singing at least those two things. That's part of the plan as we work into the future. By the way, I got an email this past week from the bishop's office, and as you may know, they want us to worship at our practicing all the safe things that we do practice and need to practice, so we're doing that. They're not even recommending that we meet with small groups yet at all, but it's hard to tell small groups not to meet. Some of you have met continually through the whole Corona experience. So that will be a call that you and your Sunday school class will make, particularly pertaining to Sunday school classes. You just let the office know as soon as you can, and we'll have it in the bulletin for you. We have a website, that information is there, and again, we appreciate those classes that are already meeting. A little bit of painting has taken place in the Cross and Flames out here. A little elves came and did this one day, and it's really nice. We appreciate the painting on the Cross and Flame. It needs to be flaming red. It's beautiful. We appreciate it. We want to extend our sympathy to Marshall and Arliss. Their daughter, Dondra's husband, Robert, his mother died this past week. So please remember that family in your prayer, and please share that with Dondra Marshall, that we're sorry about that. Notice in the bulletin we have this ICC Wesley director with us every Sunday, actually, and she's made a request that if any of our Sunday school classes would like to prepare a meal for the Wesley Foundation, please do this. You've done it in the past. About every church I've ever pastored does this at one time or the other for the Wesley Foundation. So keep that in mind. Maybe your Sunday school class would like to do that. All right. Small, the Sunday school, the youth and the children have plans for the 2nd of September to start their Wednesday night program, so keep that in mind. And then notice at the bottom of the bulletin there's a charge conference related announcement. I hope that we can do through the month of September some of our meetings pertaining to charge conference, prepare the committee, prepare the information during October, and conclude that month having charge conference. And that is the plan. So hopefully it will come to pass just that way. We appreciate you being with us today and worshiping with us. And again, during the song service, if you feel like singing, you just jump in there and start humming. You just do what you feel led to do. We just, I know it's hard to come to church and not sing publicly. That's John Wesley even, that was part of a requirement that that you do some singing in church. So, actually, I hesitate to say this, but he said we ought to sing lustfully. So you can label that what you like. But he wanted us to sing. And we will in the near future. But let's worship now. 12th Sunday of the season, so let's pray and call it.
Mighty God, your Son Jesus came to comfort fearful men and women. May we never be afraid of knowing you're with us. Take heart and faithfully serve Christ, our Lord and Savior. And in the name of Christ, let his church say, placing the offering plates in the back of the church and at this door right here for your convenience. Let us pray. God our Father, we thank you again for the privilege of coming into your house of worship and worshiping you publicly, gracious God. It is a privilege to gather in your house of worship. There is something to be gained from seeing fellow Christians and renewing our faith together, growing in faith together, studying your scripture together, humming along the hymns, gracious God. What a privilege it is to gather and to be with us as we go out into the world to represent you to the best of our abilities. Thank you for again, this privilege, this day, the Sunday school classes that have met, the groups that are meeting, the youth, the children, all that's going on with the children that are meeting and going back to school, we lift them unto you. We just ask your blessings upon them as well. God bless our community. God bless all of the communities. And bless us as a nation and people. And help us always to be thankful. In your name we give thanks, and in your name we pray. Amen. And as the ushers go back, we'll ask you to join with us in the doxology. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above in heaven and earth. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Chapter that's full of very, very important information for us. In this chapter, we read about Jesus getting word that his cousin John the Baptist had been executed. He's been killed. You can only imagine how Jesus felt. He goes away to a deserted place and prays. And as he comes back from this place, 5,000 people are on the hillside and they're hungry. And Jesus proceeds to feed them with 5 loaves and 2 fish. And you know that story. Well, before the chapter is over, after that experience, Jesus goes again to a lonely place to pray. At this time, the disciples decide to go fishing. It's night. They did a lot of fishing on the Sea of Galilee at night. You've heard us talk before about Magdala, Watchtower. There was a city called Magdala there on the west side of the Sea of Galilee. Had a tower. And this tower was actually used as a lighthouse for the fishermen on the Sea of Galilee. It was an earthen tower. The top of it, they would build fires so that those fishermen out on the Sea of Galilee at night could get their bearings and know where they were. The Sea of Galilee is about 3 miles wide and about 6 miles long. And the sea can get pretty turbulent. We don't know if that watchtower was working that night or not. But the disciples go fishing. Jesus has been in a deserted place praying, and now the scripture unfolds before us, and we're going to read this passage of Jesus walking on the water, beginning in verse 22. So immediately, and this is right after the feeding of the 5,000, immediately he made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead to the other side while he dismissed the crowd. And after he had dismissed the crowd, he went up the mountain by himself to pray. Deserted place to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But by this time, the boat was being battered by the waves and was far from the land, for the wind was against them. And early in the morning, he came walking toward them on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "Is it a ghost?" And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I, do not be afraid." Did you see the topic of our bulletin this morning, the message? That's the topic of our message right there. Take heart, it is I, do not be afraid. Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." I love this rhetoric going on between Peter and Jesus. You know, if it's you, come in. And Jesus literally says, "Come on in, the water's fine." Literally, he says that. He said, come. So Peter got out of the boat and started walking on the water and came toward Jesus. But when he noticed the strong wind, he became afraid and frightened and began to sink. And he cried out, "Lord, save me." Isn't it interesting that quite often when we find ourselves sinking, whether it's the Sea of Galilee and Simon Peter, or whether it's the swamp and the muck and the mire of life itself that we find ourselves in, that's quite often when we say, "Lord, save me," or "Lord, save us." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying to him, "You have little faith. Why did you doubt?" And when they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshiped him. It's very important right there. The fact that they were in the boat and they worshiped. It's important to the story. Saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." This is the word of God for the people of God, and thanks be to God. I've read this text many times, and you have as well. You've had it in Sunday school lessons, Sunday school classes. You've read it. You've probably heard many, many messages on it. There's a lot of things that can be said about this wonderful passage of Scripture. The Sea of Galilee itself is just a magnificent, beautiful, pristine, big lake. And the people that have maintained it now for 2,000 years have worked real hard at trying to keep it as pristine and as beautiful as ever. And it is. It is. They will not allow anyone to build high-rise buildings around it because, of course, that would take away from the beauty of the setting of the Sea of Galilee. Actually, there is a high-rise down in Tiberias that is the mouth of where the mouth of the Sea of Galilee is, where it feeds into the Jordan. In Tiberias, there is a high-rise. It's about 10 stories high. I've stayed in that hotel, but that's the only one in the area around the Sea of Galilee. They try to maintain the beautiful, pristine setting. Here's something, though, I read recently that was proposed. A group of people proposed that they would go to the Sea of Galilee, and about 100 yards offshore, they would build a pier right below the surface of the water, about half an inch below the surface of the water. Paint the top of the pier the same color of the water. Put buoys on all four corners and charge people $300 to drive them out there and give them the privilege of walking on the water on the Sea of Galilee, what would look like walking on the water, walking on the pier. Well, that failed. Of course, thank goodness the commercialism of that is terrible. But you can see how some people might really want to have that experience. Notice this also about this story. They're in a ship. The disciples are in the ship. Simon Peter's in this fishing boat, this ship. Did you know the ship itself is a beautiful Christian symbol, just like the cross and like the fish? But the ship is also the very church that we're worshiping in. All churches are built, or even patterned after, or either the ship is patterned after the church, or the church is patterned after the ship. Not quite sure. But the Christian church took the ship on as a symbol, an image. If you notice, in all of these old ships, there's a pulpit. There's a pulpit area. All you have to do is look at the ships of antiquity and see them. Usually there's a rail. Look at all the old pirate ships. There's a rail there separating the pulpit area, the mast area, from the rest of the nave of the church, of the ship. Now, the nave of a ship, that's what it's called. The nave, this is the center part of the church. It's called the same thing. It's a nave. And why? It's a navy term, nautical term. This is a pattern after a ship. This is where the great cargo is kept. Now, what separates, again, the sanctuary, which is this part of the church, from the nave is the rail. And what makes this so special is that it has an altar. An altar. But I think that's interesting, too. Notice in the last verse of the scripture that we read, notice, and those in the boat worshiped him. They were worshiping in the boat. We can actually say this is one of the first Christian churches. Yes. Now, you know this story very well. I think you do, or you heard me read it just a moment ago. The disciples are in the boat. It's late at night. It's early in the morning. Jesus comes walking toward them. They're very fearful. They're very scared. Is it a ghost? Lord, is it you? And Simon Peter, has this, he's just that way. He's that kind of guy. He says, Lord, if it's you, bid me to come to you. Jesus says, well, come on. Come on, the water's fine. And then he gets out and he starts sinking because he realizes what he's doing and where he is. And Jesus takes him by the hand and says, oh, you have little faith. The first point we'd like to make this morning is quite simple. It may seem, you want to hear me out, though. Hear the first point clearly before you make an assumption. Walking on water could be a common experience. if we associate that with simply risk-taking. It took an effort. That's Simon Peter stepping out of the boat. The very fact that he did that is what this sermon is about today. Not the fact that he walked on the water, but the fact that he got out of the boat. What a risk. What a risk that was. You know, life is full of risk, isn't it? Risk taking. You know, you're risking something to get out in public worship, aren't you? It's kind of risky. Some people are into big-time risking, adventurous, those extreme sports that we hear about. People used to go over Niagara Falls in a barrel. People used to walk on tightrope over a portion of the Grand Canyon. And people try to jump the Grand Canyon on motorcycles. All this is extreme stuff, isn't it? Risky stuff. Y'all do know, we went yesterday as a family up to the cemetery again where my dad was buried. And as we were going, my daughter was playing some of this Jim Foxworthy stuff on the radio. He did say, you do know the last words of the redneck, don't you? Hey, y'all, watch this. There's some risk taking is just downright stupid. It's not just extreme, it's stupid. And I thought this as I was preparing this message. Think of the risk takers in our nation, in the history of our nation, in our country. We used to really admire those people that would step out and lead the way, but boy, they've become villainized. Think about Christopher Columbus. I don't know all that he did. I don't know all that he's responsible for. But I'll tell you what I found out in the last 6 months. I didn't know. I didn't know there were so many statues of that man in this country. They seem to be all over the place and being defaced, and people are tearing them down. But if not for somebody like him discovering the Americas, we owe him something. He was a pioneer. What about all of those pioneers that we know of? Horace Greeley said, go west, young man. How about those people that went west in covered wagons? They're called pioneers. They usually take the arrows, don't they? But they have been villainized by our modern woke culture today. Yes, the pioneers. Even in the army, there's a group of guys and gals that are called rangers that lead the way, go out there, the ones that usually our leaders, they take, and they have been villainized also. Some people, by their very nature, are risk takers. Experience tells us this. Now, all of us want our children to be a little adventurous, you know, be able to step out and to do things and accomplish things, but not one of us want our children to be risk takers, do we? Which brings us to another point. Without people who try to walk on water, risk taking. Without people who try, the world would never move forward. Everything is risky. We would never get anything done if we didn't take risk at all. What about marriage itself? Marriage. You would be blind if you didn't know that there's been a decline in marriage for the last 3 decades. Yes, you'd be blind if you hadn't noticed that, of course. And why is that? Well, for anyone to say this is the reason or that's the reason, it would be a mistake. But one thing we do know is true, it's kind of risky. Getting married. Trusting your life to someone else, significant other, saying till death us do part. Yes, it is. That might be one of the reasons. I don't know. I thought about the lady that, it's kind of humorous, so this is a good story, that she was walking down the sidewalk and all of a sudden she hears this voice that says, stop. So she stops and a big piano falls right in front of her. Kept walking, would have killed her. Wow, she's thankful for that voice. The next day, she's at a pedestrian crossway, and she's got her phone looking at it, and the light changed, and she gets ready to walk across the street, and the voice says, stop! So she stops. And a runaway car just runs by, the brakes had quit working. It would have killed her for sure if she stepped out. So she looks up and says, where's this voice coming from? And the voice says, I'm your guardian angel. I've been watching after you for years. And she puts her hands on her hip and looks up and angrily says, well, where were you at when I got married? The truth is, we would never have anything if we were not risk takers. Like I said, you would not be here this morning. We would not have any Sunday school classes going on or a worship service if you were not risk takers to a degree. We would have no new relationships. There would be no new businesses. There would be no homes. Here's a couple of illustrations I thought I found. Helen Keller said, life is either a daring adventure or nothing. One sports figure said, you miss 100% of the shots you never take. Right? Mark Twain says, 20 years from now, you'll be more disappointed with the things you didn't do than You'll be more disappointed by the things that you didn't do than by the things that you did. So throw off the bow lines, sail away to the safe harbor, catch the trade winds in your sail, explore, dream, and discover. So are the words of Mark Twain. Here's an illustration that came to me from my own life experience. And I hope you get something out of this illustration. I want you to think about this. Is our Christian life more like a motorcycle? Or is it more like a lawnmower? Now, there's a reason I want to use that as an illustration. Because a motorcycle is quite daring. You know, you get on that thing and latch it back and the wind blows. And I've threatened to get a motorcycle a few times in my life, and my wife says, if you do, you make sure you get life insurance on the way home. So I've not got one yet. And the difference between that and a lawnmower is a lawnmower is trustworthy. It's functional. It's slow. It gets the job done, doesn't it? When you get through, you look at it, oh, your yard is manicured, beautiful, and you feel good. Okay? So is life more like a motorcycle or a lawnmower? Now, this came to me one day when I was shopping for a lawnmower. I go into this store, and they sell lawnmowers, four-wheelers, motorcycles, and I see this big Honda 750. I go up to it, and I'm looking at this thing. All of a sudden, a salesman comes over, and I guess he wanted everybody in the store to hear it, especially his boss, because he started selling this product. I mean, he was putting on a show. He was telling me how fast this thing would go, how beautiful it is, how dynamic of a motorcycle it is. And by the way, he said also it's a real chick magnet. You'll really, okay? Well, after, and he invariably he asked me what I did for a living. And I said, well, I'm a minister. And as quick as I said that, his tone and demeanor changed entirely. He got quieter, calm, and he started talking about the practicality of that motorcycle. He started saying, it's very economical, it's great transportation, it's just a wonderful way to get to work. And I said, well, I'm really not here to look at motorcycles. I'm here to look at lawnmowers. So he goes over and he proceeds to sell lawnmowers the very same way he sold the motorcycles. Well, maybe, I'll come back to that illustration in a moment, but maybe Jesus was testing Simon Peter that night on the Sea of Galilee when he jumps out of the boat. The very fact that he did get out of the boat. Or maybe it's why Peter became the leader of the church and not Paul. by Roman friends called St. Peter the first pope of the church. Peter became a great leader. All of this may be going into the pot that makes Simon Peter the great dynamic church leader that he was. He needed somebody, that is, Jesus needed somebody not to walk on water, but someone willing to get out of the boat. So let me say this about the motorcycle and the lawnmower. Whenever the church, has had a great effect on humanity, historically, it did not act like a lawnmower. It acted like a powerful motorcycle. 500 years ago, during the Protestant Reformation in Martin Luther, it was wide open. About 280 years ago, in England, across the English Channel, they were having a terrible bloody revolution. And the only reason it didn't cross the English Channel was because of people like George Whitefield, George and Charles Wesley, that were preaching the gospel of Christ and inviting people to come, rich and poor, one and all. The church was wide open. And it makes me, thinking about that, using that illustration of a motorcycle and the lawnmower, it makes me realize how safe and secure we have become in the church. Just think about it with me. Explore this with me. Now let me tell you, I love safety and security. Okay? I love it. I love it. I'm glad you've got your mask on, and I'm glad you're practicing safe distancing. I believe in safety and security. But you know, once upon a time, the church challenged people. Step out. Step out. Walk forward. Come forward. Receive Christ. Get out of the boat. Once the church challenged people. Where are our battlefields today? Do we have any? Do we care to? Well, if we take too big of a stand, we're called political. You know what? I've been called political just about as much as I've been asked to be political. You get it? It's about 50, it's about six of one, half a dozen of the other. For some people, I'm too political. And for others, I'm not political enough, especially if I'm not preaching their message or the message they want to hear. Where are the battlefields? Where are the challenges? Has the world gotten safer? Has the world gotten more loving? Has the world gotten more just? Has the world gotten more Christ-like? Or have we retreated to our own safe harbor? Are we more like a motorcycle or a lawnmower? Only as we attempt great things, God's not asking you to walk on water, but He might be asking you to get out of the boat. Only as we attempt great things do we experience how great God is. Risking great things for God is really no risk at all. God is with us, just like He was the disciples. What you need to do is just always do this. Filter it through the Bible. Political, non-political, whatever, what to do, what not to do. Filter it through the Scriptures. The Scriptures will never lead you wrong. The Bible will not lead you wrong. Stick with the Bible. How long has it been since you took a risk for God? Think about it. How long has it been since we risked anything for God? Perhaps someone has said something about the church. Let's say this. Perhaps someone has said something about the Methodist church. Did you defend your church? Well, I know we're having so many problems in the church today. I have a hard time defending it. Right? I think about that a lot. There are two basic reasons I am in the denomination I'm in. Let me share those with you. I've done it before, but it's important to me. They're the sacraments. Our understanding of the sacraments. Holy Communion and baptism. We believe in baptism. We believe in it so much, and we believe in it so strong that we believe when a child is baptized, when a child of God is baptized, who baptizes that person? The clergy, the church, or is it the Spirit of God? Water represents the Spirit. So if God baptized you, one of our strong Methodist beliefs is it needs not be repeated. That's why when a person from another denomination joins this church, we accept their baptism. Because they've been baptized by the Spirit of God. We believe in baptism that strong. And when somebody wants to re-baptize you because you hadn't experienced what we've experienced, then they're actually saying through that act that your initial baptism was null and void. It wasn't even valid. No human being, no denomination has the right to do that. I believe in baptism. I believe water baptism represents spiritual baptism. You must be baptized. That's why I'm a Methodist. I also believe in Holy Communion, the Lord's Supper. I believe it represents the body and the blood of Christ. And we open it up to anyone and everyone. Anyone and everyone that wants to receive the sacrament is welcome. Now, I've been places where I could not take communion because I was not a member of that church or was not one of them. We don't practice closed communion. It's open. And you might say, well, only born-again Christians are supposed to take communion. Right, that's biblical. But who are you to say that that person that's coming forward are in their pew when they take the communion is not using it as a means of grace, even in itself, and becoming a Christian? We'd be pretty narrow-minded and shallow spiritually to do that. That's why we offer communion to anyone who will receive it. So there may be a lot of reasons we could not defend the Methodist Church, but not those two reasons. I defend it on those reasons. Well, maybe it's not the church, the Methodist church or the denomination that you had to defend. Maybe it's the church itself. I've heard people say, I'm tired of the church. You know, I'm tired of those old hypocrites, all they are, and I'm an agnostic or an atheist, and I don't care for the church. Have you defended the church when you people talk like that? Have you tried to call their hand, step out of the boat a little bit and risk it? Have you tried to defend the church? Let me tell you, when you defend the church, you're defending the bride of Jesus. The book of Revelation calls the church the bride of Christ. I've heard people talk about the church. I don't want to hear anybody talk about the church because you're talking about the bride of Jesus. Does it have blemishes? Is it flawed? Of course it is. But I'll let you talk about it all you want to. But you're not going to catch me talking about the bride of Christ, okay? How long has it been since you took a simple risk of inviting a neighbor or someone to church or to your Sunday school class? Maybe you do this regularly. Got out of the boat at all? Have you invited someone to church? Or is it too risky? You know, I'm not going to risk that. I'm not going to push it. I'm not going to take any risk. I'm going to stay in the safe harbor. I'll just stay in the boat. What if Simon Peter took that approach? Would he have ever been the saint and the rock on which the church was built? It's a good question. What great risk as a church are we taking for God? Here's where I'm going to put it right on you. At this point, I think there's more responsibility on you as lay people than it is on me as clergy. Many of you are very quick to say, that's your job, preacher. That's what we pay you for. That's your job. Notice who Jesus was talking to in this boat. Did you get it? Did you hear that? This church, this boat that he was in. He said, take heart, it is I, do not be afraid. He was not saying that to Simon Peter. He was saying it to the disciples on this boat. And when the calm sea took over, Jesus and Simon Peter were in the boat, verse 33, and those in the boat worshiped him. I mean, it was on them. They were the church. They were the ones that were to represent Christ. That's why we call this a nave. It's where the most important body of the church rests, the body of the ship. He was addressing the church. He was talking to Simon Peter also, but mostly it was directed to the church. The church has a wonderful, awesome, beautiful responsibility. So does the clergy, of course. And people are really quick to tell you what the clergy's responsibility is. But what about the lay? What about the Christian? You have a responsibility also to represent Christ. You can either stay in the boat, get out, risk a little bit for Christ, a lot, not much, or a lot for Christ's sake. But it was quite risky, wasn't it, on that night on the Sea of Galilee when the storm was raging. Lord, if it's you, bid me to come to you. And Jesus says, well, come on in. The water's fine. Well, come on in. There's so many ways that we can serve the Lord. Sunday school classes can do so many different things in ministry. So many different ways we can serve the Lord. Take a little chance. Thank you for taking a chance today to come out and publicly worship. And may God bless you for doing it. Let's have our closing and invitational hymn.
Savior. You're his disciples. You're his church. We're to go forth into the world and show his love, his compassion,